Hey everyone, in this video I'm going to be referencing an article, this one posted to Freebird Media Canada by Maurice Porter on December 12, 2018. Now I saw this particular article when it was shared by Alex Van Ham, one of the co-founders of Freebird Media Canada. I believe it was on his Facebook page. And of course, when I see some of these articles or information presented by some of these alternative sources that I follow, I want to learn and understand what their stance or position or what it is that they're trying to say contained within their articles. And it didn't take me very long, once again, because I see this happen so many times, especially when you're talking about the philosophy of liberty or what being a libertarian is all about or what is libertarian philosophy. I see so many times by people in the established media or proponents or supporters of those in established political parties, political pundits, pollsters, and even some of those in the alternative media or even some people that actually call themselves libertarians. I see many times where people completely misrepresent and misconstrue what the philosophy of liberty entails, which is basically, let me just tell you, it's just a philosophical endeavor to understand what it means to be a free human being, to be free from forced subjugation, indentured servitude, slavery, or forced wealth or income redistribution. What does it mean to be a free human being? That is the intellectual and philosophical endeavor of libertarians. And like I say, it goes all the way back to now. Now, you can go all the way back to Aristotle, right? 2,500 years ago. Now, Aristotle wouldn't identify as a libertarian, but he too, just like a lot of the Greek philosophers back, you know, like I say, going back 2,500 years, that were trying to understand and grasp on these concepts of what does it mean to be free? So like I say, this is a human endeavor that probably goes back even much further than that, but of modern recorded knowledge that we know or historical recorded knowledge, like I say, it goes back to at least 2,500 years and has culminated and been built upon for all this time right up till modern day today in 2018. And you've had a lot of intellectual giants and geniuses that have built upon and expanded upon what it is, what it entails, what are the prerequisite requirements to be a free human being. And when you acknowledge the fact that, like I say, a lot of people put on a lot of work over decades of their own lives, and like I said, built upon the geniuses from the historical past. So like I say, we've all, even myself, I stand upon the shoulders of some very, very intelligent human beings over the course of millennia, to be able to have the kind of grasp, understand of what it means to be a free human being today, and to be able to articulate it in a manner that should be easily understood by most. Now, what we're seeing there today is the people that aren't susceptible to this kind of rather simple knowledge are a representation of the fact that they've been indoctrinated by sophists or those who want to be their authority or their rulers, right? So the sophists or the political or ruling class, they've been constantly trying to misrepresent and misconstrue what it means to be a free human being. That's literally their point. That is their go-to position because that's how they seek out to be your authority. It's always under the guise of benevolence and they want you to be free. It's just that they know what's best for you much more than you could ever know. Anyways, back to the article. So like I say, it only took me to scroll down to the very first part of this article. Now, the first sentence was, what does it mean to be sovereign? Why would someone ask that question or pose that question at the very beginning of the article without being prudent enough to place a link or a quotation of a dictionary definition of what does sovereignty mean? Because like I say, we don't get to just conjure up in our mind and make up whatever we want sovereignty to mean. It actually has a predefined meaning that can be found in, like I say, in any one of our dictionaries, whether it's online or even if you go to the local library or if you've got one laying around your house. You can find the defined meaning of sovereignty there. Or if you don't want to do it that way, you can just pivot to a search engine like Google, like what I'm going to do right now. Actually, I've already done it. I already had it set up for this video, but you know, think about how long it would take to type in sovereignty. Not long, right? But here it is. Sovereignty. Supreme power or authority. And they use a quotation underneath that says, how can we hope to wrestle sovereignty away from the oligarchy and back to the people? So, like I said, sovereignty has a predefined meaning. The most dominant aspect, the most dominant area of that meaning of the word is supreme power authority. So, as me as a human being, who should have supreme power authority over me, my mind, and my body? Authority, right? Authority and power over it. Of course it should be me. That's what it means to be a free human being. That's what was the very basis and premise of ending slavery, was the fact that no human being is owned by anyone else. To be a sovereign, to be a free human being, is to acknowledge that you're the rightful owner and authority over your own mind, your body, and everything that makes you, you. That's what a sovereign is. Anyways, back to this article once again, because like I said, it only took the second sentence into this article to raise the alarm bells for me, because this is someone that's once again misrepresented what it is to be a free human being, or what libertarian thought, or what the philosophy of liberty entails. Libertarians argue that sovereignty lies in property. No? Well, unless you consider, like I say, that actually is a kind of truthful statement, but that property means me. My property is my body, my mind, right? It's not the things that I produce, which is actually the extension of my own personal property, which is my mind, my hand, you know, my labor, and how that all works together to create something. I can create something with the property of my mind and the property of my body, and create another form of property in the sense that I can whittle a piece of tree into an arrow. That would be my property. But that only comes to fruition because I used my mind and my body to produce it. So the original concept of property is self-ownership. And is this person arguing against self-ownership? Because to argue against or in contrast to self-ownership is to suggest that someone else has a higher claim or authority on you than you do. Let's read on and see what this person's referencing here. While often failing to realize your property is only yours insofar as you can possess it. Like I said, since property in its truest form, in its original inception, in regards to what libertarian philosophy espouses, is me. I own me. Self-ownership. How else is someone going to possess me? Unless they do it by way of force, right? Federalists argue that sovereignty lies in regional autonomy, while failing to realize that autonomy is always afforded by some imperial authority. The truth that seems to underlie these conceptions of sovereignty is that the right to self-determination is based on the ability to self-determine. In other words, sovereignty is based in power, just as what is right is based on which is mighty enough to claim the title of justice. In this respect, it's worth noting that the individual or their own is not as strong as the tribe. You know, I got to be honest with you, I still don't know what this person's trying to suggest in that particular paragraph. As strong as the tribe? What the hell does that have to do with the sovereignty of the individual? Whether they're as strong as a tribe or not, are you suggesting that might makes right? Because that's not what the libertarian thought or the philosophy of liberty entails, or even suggests or puts forth. So, like, I don't know where this person's even going. Matter of fact, I'd love to have a conversation with this person so they could clarify the kind of premise that they're suggesting in this article, because right now it's still very foggy, very confusing for me. How sovereign is Canada? First of all, what are you talking about, Canada? Canada is a geographical landmass that human beings laid claim to. Like I say, the trees or the grass or the animals, they're not out there protesting or petitioning the government, right? So can we talk about human fucking beings here? Because really, that's what we should be referencing. This is the problem with using collective thought or things that are based on nothing that's grounded or entrenched on anything that even represents the human experience. Canada is Canada. A group is a group. Once again, it denies, this person is trying to talk without acknowledging the individual or the sovereignty of the individual contained within. What Canada is comprised of, I think we're at 37 million sovereign individuals or people that should be considered sovereign individuals. Its sovereignty does not lie in the extent to which the provinces have their own regional autonomy. As a nation state, its sovereignty lies in the might of its authority, both internally and externally. What the fuck does any of this shit mean? A nation state can't do shit. Lord fucking have mercy. When I'm seeing all the time, I'm looking on the map. I've never seen any portion of the map or the geographical composition of Canada moving around or stand up doing anything. I recognize that actually land is usually, for the most part, pretty quiet about things. Same with the trees, same with the animals, same with the grass, same with the rocks, same with the sand, same with the oceans. I don't hear any one of these things that, you know, would comprise a country or lakes or rivers. I don't hear any of these things that comprise and represent a country or a geographical area. I don't see this pertaining to any of that. So can, like I say, can we just talk about human beings? But once again, this is a problem with people like this that talk from the collective senses. They just, without acknowledging the individual, once again, this is the kind of logic. That's what you're left with for your logic. It's all based on, like the group. What is the group? If not a bunch of individuals. But if you just refer to the group, then you're completely ignoring the individuals that are contained within the group. So once again, you can't have any proper dialogue. You can't have a proper philosophy, and that's what we're seeing today. Actually, this is the culmination of why the philosophy of collectivism fails everywhere it's implemented or imposed upon the people, because people don't function as a state or as a group. People function as individuals. We're born as individuals. We're raised as individuals. Our brains think like individuals. Why? Because we have one brain per person. Like, come on. Anyways, like I said, I'll read a little bit into this, but I really, hey, Alex, if you're watching this video, please get a hold of this guy. Tell him that, yeah, he needs to really have a chat with a libertarian so that he can break free from some of this. Like, I don't know, like I say, wow. You're not helping to educate and inform anyone with this kind of nonsense. And the real question is, how can any citizen of this nation state settle for anything less than becoming as strong as we can? To what extent has our weakness interfered with the very means by which higher standards of living are brought about? Canada is one of the most resource-rich and largest countries in the world, yet we only put 7% of our land to use. Why don't we put more of this to use? Canada's in the top 15% of countries based upon population size, yet it is worth noting that Canada's in the bottom 25% of countries in terms of the size of its military. Why don't we use more of our population to protect our land? If Canadians put more land to use, they might value it more. And if they valued it more, they might come to want to protect it more. But something interferes from both a more productive and militaristic agenda. Anyways, now it goes on to somewhat of like a quasi-history lesson. But once again, it's so... As someone that has read, man, you can't even imagine how many books, articles, and publications that I've read over just the last 10 years alone. And I got to tell you, this stuff here, the way this is written, this person didn't elevate or educate or inform me. I mean, I'm actually more confused now than I was when I first started out. And I was already starting out confused because this person suggested that libertarians are all about property. No, self-ownership, the non-aggression principle, right? And property rights, which once again requires that you understand that to have any pretense of property rights is self-ownership. The fact that this person left the most important aspect of what it is to be free human being out of the equation entirely tells me that it's someone that either hasn't put a whole lot of effort or thought into what the philosophy of liberty entails, or they're trying to purposely misconstrue or misrepresent what it means. I can't suggest that I know which one or which way this person is coming about it in regards to this article, but I can ask them to let's have a conversation so you can clarify for not just me and yourself, but anyone else that reads this kind of stuff, what the hell are you trying to say? Really? Let's, like I say, clarity of thought, clarity of mind requires clarity of language. If you have a conversation with me, I'm going to clarify the language for you. Because, yeah, I don't allow people to just make up their own definitions of the terms and words we use. Now, you're going to have to stick to the defined means just like I do. It's Canadian Libertarian, and I love liberty.